Hello friends, welcome to Achieve IAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and from today onwards we have also started a dedicated series in which we will daily evaluate your we will do daily analysis of the Indian Express newspaper. So we will be making two videos, one for the analysis of editorials and one for the analysis of the news. So this video is about your analysis of the editorials of the Indian Express. So today is as you know that 19 April. So let's see what is the first article. So the first article here is before us is the closing the gender gap. So it is a very nice article that has been given in today's newspaper. So it is written by Angelica Aribam. So she is a prominent political activist. So as you know that friends, 2019 general elections are coming, and there is campaigning going on everywhere in India, and more and more places are there in which the elections have been taking place. So in this scenario there are multiple debates that come into the political scene. So there is one continuous debate in India about the representation of women in politics. So this article is about the representation of women in the political institutions. So this article basically I will not explain every line, but simply I will give you a gist of this article, that what this article wants to say. So if friends, if we see, then simply the one thing that is important that is highlighted by this lady is that though there are multiple parties which are saying this year we will be introducing a women reservation bill for the representation of women in parliament, but even now if we consider the number of tickets that are allotted to different women by different parties, it is not that much. For example, here she takes the example of BJP as well as your Congress. So let me zoom in so you can see here that Congress and Bharatiya Janata Party have given tickets to 13.7% women and 12% seats respectively. So there is not that much representation of women even now. So you can see here, and in case if these parties are willing, then why they are not granting the reservation at the first place itself, so they can give the large number of seats. If 33% is the reservation women is talked about the reservation of women, then if we see the 2019 elections, only 13.7% seats are given to women by Congress and 12% by the BJP. So but in contrast, she tries to say that the regional party that is Trinamool Congress has given a quite large number of seats to the women, that is for example 40%, whereas the Biju Janata Dal has followed the suit, giving 33.3% of the seats for women. So there is a quite improvement that has been seen in the regional parties, but now the question arises that why we need the women reservation bill. So there is every time when there are general elections or elections to the legislative assemblies, so there comes a demand of the women representation reservation bill. So at the first place there is a question that why it should be there. So friends, let me tell you that in fact in this article also it is written by it is substantiated by providing a data that is 11.8% women are in parliament currently. So you can see that only the whole parliament, out of the whole parliament only 11.8 are women. So there is a kind of, we can say, gloomy representation of women in the parliament. So if the women are not in the decision making institutions, then certainly our policies that we are introducing for the development of India, or for that matter for the inclusiveness of India, that will not be that much effective unless and until we incorporate more and more people from diverse backgrounds. So in case the gender which forms half of the population of India, if in case it doesn't have a proportional representation in your decision making bodies, then certainly it will cost the inclusiveness of our development. Another thing is important here is that globally there are now more than 100 countries that have affirmation action policies for women in politics. Especially this started after the World Conference for Women that was held in Beijing. So purpose is ultimately the whole purpose is to give representation to women. So there are she further explains that there are three forms of gender representation that is widely prevalent around the world, that is fixed reservation seats and your electoral quota on rotational basis, and your voluntary party quota that is given by a particular party as per its wish. So fixed quota means, friends, if you talk about the fixed quota, then for example, say if there are 100 seats, then 33 seats are allotted to women, and it is not seen that it is not in rotational basis, but just 33% seats are given. So 33 seats are given to women and they can be elected from anywhere. And the second part that the second type of quota that this writer explains is that of on rotational basis. For example, 33% seats are reserved and they are continuously on rotation basis, covering different regions of India, or for that matter, covering different geographies of a particular country. So other method is of giving the voluntary political party quota. So this the currently that we in India the debate is going on, it is associated with this second category, that is quota on rotational basis. 33% of the it is said that 33% of the seats must be reserved for the women on rotational basis. So this form of reservation is not new in India. In fact, it is not in parliament or legislative assemblies, but if we see our local bodies, then it is certainly there. So it is argued that 33% seats are reserved and they must be on rotational basis, and that must be in parliament also and in legislative assemblies also. But there are some arguments that political parties can voluntarily give their tickets to the women candidates. But there are a lot of reservations about it, as the writer points out. So for example, the countries that in Latin America, for example Africa and Europe, that have adopted this policy of allocating voluntarily a certain number of seats to the women in their political structure, in their party, it has been seen that that representation of women has not increased. So there are multiple reasons for it. For example, currently now the countries that have or the continents that have this voluntary basis of reservation, only 20% of women are there in the parliament. So there are multiple reasons. For example, when this type of quota is there, when political parties choose for voluntary allocation, then the women candidates are generally given those seats which are non-winnable seats. So the seats which a particular political party sees that it cannot win, they are allocated to the women. So women candidates. So merely to fulfill the quota requirements of the party. And in fact, it is seen that there is no level playing field. And also studies have revealed that there is tend to receive less. The women receive less funds as compared to when they are contesting against a male candidates. So there is a kind of entrenched, we can say there is entrenched patriarchy in our society, in which when women are fighting elections against men, then it is studies have shown that women are they're less likely to receive funds as compared to their male counterparts. So certainly there is no level playing field, and these combined factors result in a lack of fulfillment of end goal. And what is end goal? It is the reservation or for that matter greater representation for women. So here the writer gives her personal example, which is not of relevance here, but we will move to the next thing. So the author also wants to say that there is a kind of, if we follow the proper reservation on rotational basis, that is compulsorily 33% seats for the women, then it can yield better results. For example, she explains by the example of Rwanda. So in Rwanda in 1990s there were only 18% of the women in the parliament, but by constitutional legislation brought in 2003, there was a mandate to allocate to for kind of reserve 30 50% of the whole parliament seats to the women. So due to this, what happened in the elections in the same year, 50% of women made it to the Rwandan parliament. Similarly, this percentage improved in the subsequent elections in 2008 and 2013. So as of now in Rwanda, 64% of the women make this parliament, and it is the highest proportion in the world. So you can see that the country that is not that much developed is setting an example in women empowerment. So this if we make a proper women reservation bill, then this such can be the results, such can be the fruits of these this reservation. So also another thing that author wants to say that it is important that in this perspective that the women reservation bill be passed. So earlier, so it is a kind of outside intervention to the political parties, resulting in striving for gender parity within the system. So in fact, as I have told you that we already have gender representation at grassroots levels, because earlier when there was no constitutional provision of Panchayati Raj institutions, or for that matter municipalities, the representation of women was just 3-4%. But after the passing of the 73rd and 74th amendments and the compulsory reservation of women, the percentage of representation of women increased to 43%. So from 3-4% it increased to 43%. So you can see a dramatic change in the representation of women. So ultimately, friends, if we are following the goal of inclusive growth, inclusive development, and if we want to play a dominating role or leading role in world politics and the issues facing the world, then certainly women empowerment is also a big issue in which India must lead the other countries. So there is no argument against it that reservation should not happen. So certainly it is important that women reservation bill is enacted so that 33% of the representation could be achieved. So this is about this article. So let's see what is the next article. Next article we are going to discuss is I will be covering multiple articles. So next article is what a community has lost. So friends, there might be some students who will say that there is no need to discuss this article because this is basically a biased article in which it is argued that how the Muslims are getting disenfranchised or kind of disentitled from various policies in the past 5 years of NDA government. But friends, I will basically discuss this article here because this is the major flaw in our understanding of a UPSC pattern. So UPSC is not just about building your opinion about the day-to-day challenges that India faces. So this is also one of the challenges, and if we want to understand India in a comprehensive manner, then we must have some kind of balanced opinion on controversial articles also, or on controversial topics also, which are bound to be subjective. So in this context, it is important to discuss such articles because it raises your intellectual level. You can clear the prelims and mains by having objective knowledge, but it becomes very difficult to clear the interview stage because ultimately intellectual growth is what they want in you. So if you are aspiring to be an IAS, or for that matter other you want to get into other All India Service, then you must have some kind of opinion about such things. So this article is about this is written by Shah Alam Khan. So he's a prominent doctor in AIIMS of Delhi, All India Medical Institute of Delhi. So he tries to explain here, obviously he is a Muslim, so he tries to explain that what is the difficulty that the Muslims are facing in last 5 years. So he says that there is a rise of violence and loss of life and loss of property and loss of dignity. So it has increased in 5 years, and earlier the Dalits were facing this thing, but now it has been increasing for the Muslim religion also. So there might be, let me tell you friends, that many of you people may be right wing oriented or left wing oriented. My purpose is not here to kind of build your opinion about Congress or BJP. I want to build your opinion on the important challenges that these issues could result into. So if the challenges are worth discussing, then certainly You have to look at the article. So there has been it has been said by the author that public discourse in these 5 years has not been about this disentitlement that is happening, or loss of property or loss of dignity. But the political this the discourse has changed. In fact, he says that those parties who claim to be secular, they are also not discussing these issues. So there is a kind of narrative on the Muslim laws. So what is the issue here that is talked about? That the author says that the ruling class, or for that matter any majoritarian person, he or she did not shy away from a majoritarian narrative. So this discussion becomes even urgent at the time of the election. So now we are entering the election phase. We are already in the election phase. So these issues are important. So the author explains writes the article by following an example. So he cites the example of French Revolution. So in which French Revolution, so he discusses the impact of French Revolution. So according to him, the most important thing of the French Revolution, most important impact was the empowerment of the common citizen over the ruling class. So earlier the ruling class was ruling over the common citizens, but now after French Revolution, common citizens gained their voice. So from this came the philosophies, or for that matter, practice of democracy, social justice, and entitlements. That is right-based approach. Earlier, only the rulers were entitled to various things, but now, as with the rise of common citizen, obviously they started demanding their entitlement. So this resulted in the establishment of nation states, and also the democracy, the social justice, and also this led to the birth of right of citizens. And right of citizens became paramount. So he tries to explain by this that currently, if a particular citizen is if particular person is a citizen of a nation, then he is committed to that nation by 2 reasons. For example, if I am an Indian, I'm committed to India for 2 reasons. The first reason obviously is that I will be given certain rights, certain basic rights, dignity, or my dignity, my security of life, my property, that I will be given in an assured manner. And the second thing is that I am committed to my nation because we all look for a common future. So certainly, if I am living in India, so if I am feeling like an Indian, I will only feel if I share a common feature with a patriot. For example, if you are an ardent patriot of India, so certainly I will be. If I will also follow you if I see a common future with you in India. So in case if I am not seeing the common future with you, certainly I will try to disassociate myself from the nation. So this is the two things that the author tries to say, that this entire this is the these are the two things that is the two important reasons that's why a particular citizen is committed towards its nation. But now the author says that these natural privileges of the citizenry, which a citizen expects that the government must fulfill, that is the rights of the individual must be fulfilled by the government. The author goes on to say that this entitlement is a difficult concept, and it is in case of Muslims it is now denied for last 5 years. So it is not my purpose here to explain how the Muslims are disentitled, but here my purpose is to give you valuable insight so that your intellectual growth can take place. So according similarly, he also argues that entitlement in itself is a difficult thing to explain. So it is not that case that only the Muslims are denied entitlements. The Dalits, the so-called untouchables, the women, and the economically poor sections in India are facing this problem from a quite a long time. So he also gives the theory of the explanation for theory of entitlement by articulating a book in which this theory of entitlement was given, that is Anarchy, State, and Utopia of Robert Nozick. So in which he defined the three basic principles of entitlement, that is how a person can get assured of its entitlement. Simply, friends, if you are wanting some entitlement, you are expecting something for you, then certainly you will get that thing only if there is justice, and if there is justice in accusing acquisition, if there is justice in transfer, and if in case is there is an injustice that has been done, we can say unintentionally, then there must be a rectification of that injustice. So in this manner, entitlement is basically a blend of justice and rectification of injustice. So if there is justice in India, if I am getting justice in India, certainly my rights will be protected, my right to property, my right to life, my right to dignity will be protected. And in case there is rectification of injustice, then certainly I will hope a better future in India. I will see a common future along with my other countrymen. But in case I am denied the entitlements, then certainly I am denied the justice. And also if I am denied the entitlements, and in case this denial is not rectified, then certainly I am not just given justice. I am also meted out with injustice. So this. So the author says that in case of Muslims, this has been taking place, for example, by the example of mob lynching by cow vigilants and other things also. So in this context, the most important thing the author says that such incidents should not take place, because state has the responsibility to safeguard the rights, the dignity and the independence of all the citizens of India. But in case it has been done, that there must be a rectification of injustice. But the author says that the current due process of law and the current operation of our criminal justice system has shown that various perpetrators of crime are fooling the system, and in fact they are given privilege over the others. So I will not name that lady which got today the yesterday the right to I am not able to recall the name. She got a ticket from a particular political party to fight from Bhopal, but she is accused in an important bomb blast case. So in this context, the author says that this is clearly a bettering of the rectification of injustice. So here author says that Indian Muslims are facing this problem, but certainly not only the Muslim Indians are not facing this problem, is also faced by the underprivileged people who are economically deprived sections of the country, or for that matter who are Dalits or women. So in this context we can say that there has been a kind of crisis of entitlement. So author says that puts the question forward that what is the solution then to this entitlement. Then author says that he is also not sure of this thing, and it is not necessary that a regime change or a government change may bring this entitlement, because ultimately this entitlement is you can receive only the entitlement only if there is a consciousness in the minds of the other people that the members of a particular community are also very much citizens of India as they themselves are. So in this context, if the people have this consciousness, then only the entitlements can be ensured, and then only the injustice that has been meted out can be rectified. But in case this has not been the consciousness, this has not been among the consciousness of the other people, they might be from majority or from other religion or other affiliation, then certainly the change in the government will not result in entitlement. So here author in the end says that the Muslims of India are different from the Muslims of other parts of world, because they are the only Muslims that have enjoyed the democracy for 72 years. So it author says that it is important that the democracy must show resilience and also ensure that its citizenry gets its basic entitlement, because ultimately only this will strengthen the bond of India. So why I discussed this article, because there are multiple issues that have been highlighted. So you can get the idea of entitlement from this article. Another thing you can get is the idea of your nation building, how the nation can be built, how a strong nation with strong bones, with strong spirit of brotherhood can be built in India. So certainly from that perspective, this article is important. And next article is also quite controversial, but I will discuss here. I will not leave it, because this is the major fault of every YouTuber analyzer of your The Hindu, or for that matter, any newspaper, he or she doesn't touch the controversial topic. But in fact, the most number, the best points that you can get about your about the attitude, about your opinion, about the ethics thing, you can get only from your these controversial articles. So next is your who cares. So friends, the lady, this article is in the context of the lady that has got its. Ticket from the BJP, that is the name of that lady is Pragya Thakur. So she is accused in sudden bomb blast case, but she has been given the ticket by the ruling government at this point of time. So the main points I want to the author wants to highlight here, and that I have kind of extracted from this article is that there is the first point is of kind of we can say. The seat is given to an accused person, so he is she is not that person which has a clean background. So certainly there is acquisition of a of a possible of an allegedly bombing of a particular place in which six people died and nearly 109 people got injured, but the BJP has given its ticket to it. So this has shown that there is no respect for rule of law in the country, or for that matter due process of law. So certainly friends, here the purpose is not to target any political party, but the purpose is here is of the criminalization of politics. So in this article you will get an idea about the criminalization of politics. So certainly if the lady is accused of this thing, of this bombing of a particular place, and if she is given ticket, and in case she wins, then certainly obviously criminalization of politics will take place, and also there is very much possibility that the investigation that is going against that lady that may be compromised, or that the charges may be dropped, so the investigation may not be carried out with the full, we can say, transparency. So here the multiple issues are there. First thing very important is of criminalization politics. Second thing that is of importance here is of the independence of institutions. So certainly National Investigation Agency, which is an important law enforcement agency and undertakes the anti-terror operations and anti-terror investigations, the independence of such national investigation agency could be compromised if persons with criminal background enter the politics. So there are multiple issues that I have highlighted, that is criminalization of politics, institutional independence, and other issues of no respect for rule of law, due process of law. And another thing that might got factored is that of your people's faith in democracy. So people's faith in judiciary. So if in case a person who is accused of a particular crime, if he wins and if he get votes, then certainly there will be certain people which will be kind of they will see that this is not a fair manner, and this is kind of their faith in democracy may shatter. So this also has implications for national integration, because if such persons who have committed atrocities about or against a particular religion, or for that matter a particular person, if they enter the power echelons, then certainly it will hamper the cause of national integration. So these are the basic issues that have been highlighted in this article. So you are required to read this article also. So the next article that we are going to cover is, now we have covered this choosing the gender, closing the gender gap, already we have covered. We are not covering this article, that is Our Lady Lives. Next article we are going to cover is that of this mining political gold. So friends, mining political gold, the purpose of this article is to basically understand the analytics that go into the analysis of the voting pattern. So friends, you know that we are a democracy, so every 5 years elections take place. They take place to the Lok Sabha as well as the legislative assemblies. So in this context, different political parties engage in data analyzation because they want to maximize their kind of vote tally, or because then only they can win the election. So in this context, there are multiple efforts that have been done by the different political parties to do the analysis. So this article is recently in news. Because why? Because recently the an incumbent MP, that is Menaka Gandhi, in a particular election campaign, she said that that he she said to the Muslims that they cannot expect the work from her in case if in case they didn't voted for her. So in another example, she said that in another rally she said that we will kind of categorize villages into A, B, C and D village. That is, A village will be that where we will get 80% votes, and B will be the village where we will get 60%, and C will be where we will get 50%, and then comes the D. So we will do categorize, and then we will launch the developmental politics, keeping in view the votes that that we have go, we have been given in these villages. So this article is in this context. So friends, clearly for at first ex at the first at the very first instance, this method is faulty, or and this method is immoral and unethical, because certainly when an MP gets elected, he takes an oath. So also when an MP or union minister gets appointed, he or she takes an oath of serving the country, serving the people of the country, without ill will or without kind of fear or affection to any section of society. So in this context, if this is done, then certainly this is immoral. So that's why this article I am discussing here. So here author highlights that how currently the political parties can gain access to the information about the voting patterns. So first of all, the author highlighted that voting patterns can be ascertained by the EVMs, because there is so-called Form 20 that is released by Election Commission of India, which gives clear insights into the number of votes received by a particular candidate down to each EVM. So each EVM can be analyzed by the candidates, and they can get an idea that how much votes they got from the candidates. So in this context, if there is a quite large population, and if, for example, if a village is of if a village is of 1,000 people, then if a candidate gets 600 votes, so certainly he will get an idea that this village has voted in favor of it, and what is the relevance of these people that have voted for him or her, and why they have voted for him or her. So you people can say that what is the big deal in it, because if the candidate is winning, he is certain about the votes that he has kind of, we can say, received from the voters. But friends, here the issue is of EVM level, because for example, if the elections are taking place to Legislative Assembly or Lok Sabha, and for each Lok Sabha election, for example, for a particular constituency, if elections are taking place, then there will be multiple number of EVMs that will be kind of put into place. And if the candidate is getting the detail of each EVM and is getting the detail how many number of votes he has been gaining from a particular EVM, then certainly he will get an idea that which part of the constituency is in favor of him and which part of the constituency is against him. So certainly he or she can prioritize his developmental works accordingly. So this is kind of a flaw of this Form 20, but we will not hear yet comment on this validity of Form 20 or its importance. So we in this context will also not say that we should remove Form 20, or this Form 20 should not be released by Election Commission of India. So here the author says that it is not just Form 20, there are two other things that are available to the political candidates, that is your demographics as well as contact details. So political leaning, as I have said you friends, so these are three things that are done by the political analysts who analyze the who plan the campaigns and who prioritize that how to effectively campaign in a particular constituency. So there are three things, that is political leaning, demographics and contact details. So political leaning can be ascertained by using the Form 20, but this demographics can also be helpful in multiple ways. For example, for a particular village we have a electoral roll, then people will have their names on it, will have the size of their family, they will have the address, and also their age will be also in that electoral age, electoral roll, and also their religion will be there, and also their sex will be there in the electoral roll. So certainly it is a very easy method to analyze that, for example, if particular caste is dominant in a particular region, and if it is in high number in that electoral roll, then the certainly the candidate will try to appease to that caste, because ultimately he will get the votes from that caste if he plans his campaign accordingly. So in this manner it helps political candidates to plan their campaigns accordingly. So another thing that is of immense importance to political campaign planners, it is of contact details. So contact details can be accessed through multiple other things, like there are physical or digital networks. For example, if a village has Airtel connection, or for example BSNL connection, then the government can access the contact details. So certainly after which the candidates can figure out that how much effort a particular candidate has to do in a particular constituency, or for that matter in every region of the constituency, to appease the voters. So there is nothing wrong in it, and some people say that this is a problem, and we must kind of form, we must ban Form 20 and other things. But let me tell you, friends, doing this will be a kind of compromising the transparency of election. So this cannot be done, because Form 20 cannot be it cannot be removed. It must be available to the people, to everyone, so that there must be transparency. And also it will have security implications if it is not shown. So it will also kind of cast a doubt on the election process, that is whether it is free or fair or impartial, or it is biased. So certainly Form 20 cannot be banned. But here the author says that now what to do if Form 20 data cannot be kind of kept confidential, then what can be done? So here the author says that it is the responsibility of the institutions, that is for example district developmental committees, or for that matter legislatures and election commission or other planning bodies, to see whether a particular region in a particular constituency is getting the appropriate developmental focus or not. And in case the district functionaries, or for that matter state functionaries, are finding that the legislature, or for that matter the government, is not focusing on that area, then it is the responsibility of the every person that is employed in that administrative setup to channelize his or her energy to let the development percolate to that regions also. So certainly here the point that is to be noted is that this is unethical practice to prioritize the villages on the voting pattern basis, but because ultimately a union minister, when he or she assumes office, he or she takes the oath of serving the people without any affection. So he or she must be neutral. So in this context the institutions must show their resilience, as they have shown earlier. So already there are multiple flaws in our institutions, but author says that here the only thing that can be effective is the integrity of the institutions that are serving the people. So these are the articles, four articles which we have discussed, and this article is also important. The legacy of Ambedkar. So this has been written by an important person, that is solely as J. Saurabhji, but we will not explain that article. We will explain this article in another video which we will be making about the complete analysis of Indian Express. So the as of now we have discussed your four articles, and we are ending this video. And if you like the analysis, if you like the video, then do ensure that you share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications of the updates that we do on our channel. So thank you, friends. Have a very nice day.